good morning and a really, really warm welcome to this 11 o'clock service. So good to see you all. If you are already a member of the Holy Trinity Church family, great to see you. I hope that you are keeping well. And if you're watching this for the first time, an especially warm welcome. It's really, really great to see you. We're thrilled that you're joining us for worship this morning. There have been some developments, as you will be aware, about churches opening up or emerging from lockdown. I'm going to speak a little bit about those later in the service. And I'm very aware that for many people, people are going back to work, children and young people are going back to school. And so you very, very much remain in my thoughts and prayers at this time. I hope you're all staying safe, keeping well. And we're really looking forward to being able to see one another face to face very, very soon. We're going to begin with our opening song.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Clothed with rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath, living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
So just going to share a few bits of church news just now. And it's always good to just to be aware of what's going on and changes that are happening. So first of all, concerning that news that the government announced last weekend that churches and places of worship can start to begin to open again for private prayer. Been receiving lots of guidance and advice from the diocese and from other agencies about this, and we're working on putting together a plan for what that might mean specifically for Holy Trinity. And what that probably is going to look like is that we will be able to open our doors at some point during the week, and we will be able to, people will be able to come, enter into the building, and we'll be able to just spend a short time, maybe 10, 15 minutes in private prayer. And all the protocols for social distancing and hand washing and everything will be in place. There'll be risk assessments done. And just to be clear, we're not allowed to open again for public worship. We're not allowed to gather again for worship. It is very much about individual private prayer. But at least it is a step forward, and it feels like we are a step closer to being able to gather together again at some point in the near future. So do keep an eye on our website and on our email newsletters about that. And as soon as we've got a plan together in the next couple of days, we'll share it and you will know exactly what it is we're able to do. One or two other bits of news. Of course, we have just finished our Alpha course, our online Alpha course, and a good number of people have been watching those talks online. Even though we finished the course, all those talks will be remaining online on our YouTube worship channel. So please do go on there and have a look at those talks. I'm sure there'll be stuff on there of interest to you. And if any of those talks raise any questions, then please do get in touch via alpha@holytrinityidol.org.uk. It'd be great to hear from you. And just a final notice, just to say that our building project is still on time and on schedule. So as well as all the conversations that we're having about emerging from lockdown, we're also having lots of conversations and risk assessments and all sorts of things about how we can proceed with the building work at this time. But it is looking like round about the middle of July, we are going to be commencing phase one of our building project, which involves new toilets, new storage area, a new stairwell, which will eventually lead up to the new balcony. So a really exciting time over these next couple of months. And as soon as we've got a specific start date for that work, we'll be sharing that with you all. But that's really exciting news, and it's going to look absolutely fantastic. Probably phase one will be completed before we're allowed to fully join together again for worship. And so when we're back together again in good numbers, it's going to look a little bit different, and it's going to be absolutely fantastic. So a bit of good news there for us. We're going to continue now with our next song, and then we're going to move straight into our Bible readings from Phil and Linda.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never fading. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Oh. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Come fill my life again. I give my life world the glory of the risen King. My Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
This is Romans chapter 5. Verses 1 to 8. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we are still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person. Though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates His own love for us in this. While we were all sinners, Christ died for us. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew, chapter 9, beginning to read at verse 35. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles: Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew; James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John; Philip and Bartholomew; Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector; James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus; Simon the Zealot; and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, preach this message: the kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, and drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Good morning, everybody. It's great to be able to share with you again this morning in this service of Holy Communion. You may or may not like being part of one, but they're everywhere Jesus goes. They're curious, desperate, hopeful, and often amazed. They gather in large numbers to hear his teaching. They bring to him for healing those who are sick, whether in body, mind or spirit, and they're gobsmacked when they hear Jesus telling them that the kingdom of God belongs to them. To them. So who are they? Well, they're the crowds, in the main ordinary working people. Men, women, children, known somewhat condescendingly at the time as the people of the land. But also in the crowd are tax collectors. As we know, a bunch of people hated by many for collaborating with the occupying power of Rome. And then there are prostitutes and those labelled as so-called sinners by the religious powers of the day. Mostly nameless and faceless. But as we've heard in today's gospel reading just now from Matthew chapter 9, the crowd play an important part in the unfolding drama of Jesus' public ministry in Galilee. As I've said, you may or may not like being part of a crowd. For some of you tuning in this morning, it's something you would avoid at all costs. And at the moment, there's not much chance of being in a crowd anyway. And of course, there are crowds and crowds. I have to say, I've really missed being in the crowd at Bradford City, at Headingley Cricket Ground. To me, it's a great feeling to be part of a crowd cheering your team on. I guess as football returns in the next few days, it's going to be really strange for players to be playing games behind closed doors, no crowd present. But back to Jesus and the crowd. Matthew tells us that he's been going through the towns and villages of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. It's been full on for Jesus, as it often was. He was probably in need of a break. He'd given himself out. He'd poured himself out for others. And then what happens? Another crowd of people appear. If that had been you or me, I wonder how we might have responded. Do you know what? I'm tired. I need a bit of time to chill out, to recharge. Maybe if I nip down this street and into the equivalent of the Idle Draper for a quiet pint, they won't be able to find me. But no. What do we read? When Jesus saw the crowd, he had compassion on them. Why? Well, not this time because they were physically hungry. He'd already met the needs of the crowd of thousands on that one. Not this time because of the need to bring healing to those who were physically ill. Not this time because he was facing people experiencing the pain of bereavement and loss. Now, Matthew tells us it was because they were harassed and helpless. They were like sheep without a shepherd. These ordinary folk, these people of the land, you see, were not only economically poor and suffering as a result of being under Roman occupation. Many of them actually wondered if they really mattered to God, if they counted, because by and large the religious leaders of the day had let them down. And the words in the original Greek language which Matthew uses for harassed and helpless are actually both very vivid. The word for harassed, for example, includes a sense of being worn out on a journey that you think will never end. I guess we might say an adult version of kids saying 5 minutes after you've set off on a long car journey, "Aren't we there yet?" And then the word helpless includes the meaning of being laid low or deeply wounded. I have to tell you that this is one of my favourite passages of Scripture, because in Jesus' response to what he sees in the crowd, we're shown so clearly the heart of God. And it seems to me it's also an especially relevant passage for the times we're living in. First of all, as we experience the fear and uncertainty that understandably remains within us and around us as a result of the coronavirus. But also, secondly, in terms of what we've been seeing and hearing in recent weeks since the recent murder in Minneapolis of George Floyd, and the wounds which many black people and those of ethnic minorities continue to carry as a result of prejudice, racism and hate crime. So again, that word harassed, aren't we there yet? Might that at the moment mean for us, when will some kind of normal return to our day-to-day lives? Or thinking of what happened to George Floyd, when will the day come when all people are treated with justice and dignity? And then the word helpless. Nothing we can do, is there, at the moment, apart from doing our best to stick with the government guidelines? We can't change what's happening. And George Floyd, well, he was literally laid low. And it's understandable that those in minority groups of different kinds can easily feel like the people in the crowd of Jesus' day. We just don't count. We're not seen, we're not heard, we're not understood. But Jesus looked at them and he had compassion on them. But what did that compassion look like and feel like for Jesus? What comes to your mind as you hear the word, you think about, you reflect on the word compassion? Maybe words like kindness and sympathy, and yes, absolutely. But it goes much deeper than that. Our English word compassion comes from the Latin, meaning to suffer with. It means another person's suffering becomes ours, without it overwhelming us. A willingness and ability as far as possible to enter into their situation. And a sign that we've got this means we're then motivated to try and do something about it. And to underline the strength and power of this further, the word again in the original language in Matthew to describe what compassion meant and felt like for Jesus is another very dramatic one. The Greek word is splanchnon, and it literally refers to the intestines, the guts. In the very deepest places of his being, Jesus feels the pain and is filled with tenderness and compassion. Now, of course, the ultimate way in which Jesus would show and demonstrate the passion and love of God is summed up in verse 5 of our reading from Romans 8. God proves, God demonstrates his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, the ultimate example of self-giving and compassion. I love the story which I heard some years ago of the husband who always felt he was never quite up to what his wife expected of him. And one day, in his desperation to show how much he loved her, he said this: "I'd do anything for you. I'd die for you." To which his wife rather caustically replied, "You're always saying that, but you never do it." Jesus didn't just speak of love and compassion. He did it. He paid the ultimate price on the cross of Calvary, which we remember and give thanks for in this and every service of Holy Communion. Isn't this amazing? Love so amazing, so divine. If God had to wait for us to be somehow ready and sorted, he would have a very, very long wait. As the saying goes, we're loved as we are, but loved too much to be left that way. But back to our passage in Matthew chapter 9. It's interesting that in verse 37, Jesus strikes a note of urgency as far as this compassion is concerned, with a shift in imagery. The crowds are suddenly seen as fields ripe for harvest, and labourers are needed to bring in a bumper crop. And the question is implied, who's ready and available to be a harvester? That's a call, isn't it, that's gone out in our own nation in recent weeks with a shortage of people to gather in the crops from this summer's harvest, this autumn's harvest. And what Jesus is saying here is that I want you to see as I do, the way God sees the crowd, to respond as he would, with the same self-giving kind of love, both in words and actions. It's been rightly said that most people need to see the gospel before they believe the gospel, or to use that well-known saying, walking the walk as well as talking the talk. But isn't that what we've seen happening in amazing ways over these last weeks, not least out of Holy Trinity through the Community Response Hub? And there are similar examples of that in many, many other places across our nation. People really feeling harassed and helpless, lost in many different ways, fearful, and yet experiencing the compassion of Jesus through the many volunteers being God with skin on for others. Locally here, this might come in the form of delivering food or other errands, collecting and delivering prescriptions, being a listening ear, manning phones in the church office, making bacon or veggie sausage butties every Wednesday for the wonderful unsung heroes that are our bin men. And all of this alongside the tremendous amount of creative work that's gone into producing these services. The recent Alpha course on YouTube. Words and actions, worship and service, together witnessing to our compassionate Lord. But finally, did you notice in all this that we're not called to pray for a harvest, Jesus having changed the imagery? The needs and opportunities are here, and I suspect are not going to diminish over coming weeks and months. But if we've got eyes to see and a heart to feel, there's an unexpected harvest ripening around us. So can we pray that we won't start to suffer from what's sometimes called compassion fatigue, but each of us going on playing our part as we are able, however small it may be, but they all add up together, seeing the crowds and individuals within them as Jesus does, ourselves recipients of his compassionate, saving, forgiving love, and going on being committed to living out that compassion in our words and our actions. I'd love to end with the prayer of the 16th century Teresa of Avila. Maybe some of you know this and you might like to use this maybe every day in this coming week. Christ has no body on earth but yours. No hands, no feet on earth but yours. Yours are the eyes through which he looks with compassion on the world. Yours are the feet with which he walks to do good. Yours are the hands through which he blesses the world. May it be so. Amen.
So thank you, Chris, for bringing God's word to us this morning. We move now into a time of prayer, and Kim has prepared these prayers for us. I'm going to be reading them on her behalf, but Kim has prepared them. And so could I invite you now perhaps to close your eyes or maybe adopt a posture for prayer, if that would be helpful, as we pray together. Romans chapter 12 reads, "Be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love, in honour giving preference to one another, not lagging in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord." Father God, there are so many people with so many needs, people we know and people we don't, people who are all around us and people who are far away. Enable us by the power of your Holy Spirit to be obedient to your word and to be kind, not to whom we choose, but to whom you want to reach because you love them. Enable us to see others how you see them, whoever they might be, so that we can put your loving kindness into action. Help us to do this fervently and with diligence, and to serve you with our whole heart. Forgive us, Lord, when we have been disobedient and walked away from meeting a need and forfeited your blessing. Show us how to impart your loving kindness to others in a way that they can receive your love. Enable us to be willing and unselfish. Enable us to be good servants. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would set a guard over our mouths so that we would speak only words that are good, noble, just, pure, lovely, of good report, virtuous, excellent, and praiseworthy. Enable us to speak kind words that come from your heart. We ask, Lord, not just for your loving kindness to abound in us, but also a spirit of compassion, because we know how much compassion you had for us by giving your life for us. As we continue this life here on earth, and as we walk in obedience to you and in faith, may the fruit of your spirit be manifest, and may we be your blessing to others, that they might come to know you as Lord and Saviour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. During this next prayer, there will be a short pause so that we can bring to the Lord the places in the world that come to mind as we pray. Lord of hosts, we come before you this morning as your army, your soldiers in Jesus Christ, standing firm, having put on the whole armour of God. Lord, we have seen so much hate and anger stirred up, particularly in recent weeks. And so we come before you now and we ask for your peace where hate and anger have risen as a stronghold. We ask that you would silence the voices of hate and anger and bring your healing and restoration. We ask that you would reach down your mighty hand so that your will is accomplished and not the plans of the enemy. We pray this particularly at this time over the nation of America. And for any other places and situations that come to mind, we lift them to the Lord just now. Thank you, Lord, that you have fitted us with the shoes of the gospel of peace so that we can be peacemakers. We pray that as your calm, peace and restoration takes place, that many will come to know you. We pray this not only for the ones suffering from hate and anger, but for those that are stirring it up. Help us, Lord, to continue to fast and pray for your peace until we see the answer. Help us not to be distracted, but to keep our eyes on the goal of your prayers. Thank you, Lord. We trust in you, our fortress and deliverer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And Kim writes these words. The other week, the Lord sent an unexpected messenger to my door late one evening. They handed me a verse of scripture, and I would like to share this with you, particularly if you are finding life a struggle or you are weary. I would encourage you to pray this over yourself and your family. It's from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 17. And it simply says, "But the Lord stood with me and gave me strength." Thank you, Lord, that you do stand with us, that you are for us and not against us. Thank you for your joy that gives us strength, knowing that you are Almighty God and underneath us are your everlasting arms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We join together one more time as we sing.
Shalom, shalom, peace be with you. Shalom, shalom. Shalom, peace be with you. Shalom, shalom, shalom. Shalom, shalom, peace be with you. Shalom, shalom, my child. Shalom, shalom. Always by your side. May peace beyond all understanding fill your heart and mind. Shalom, shalom, peace be with you. Shalom, shalom.
Your love.
So we come now to the lovely part of the service where we share bread and wine together. And the words will be on the screen. And if you would like to join in with the words in yellow, that would be great. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night that he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, Jesus took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, Jesus gave you thanks. He said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. And so as we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. And so with your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and we lift our voices to join the eternal song of heaven, saying together, "Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest." And so as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And so we break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you in eternal life. And so, having shared in this special meal together, this Holy Communion, we say the prayer of thanksgiving. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. We join together by singing our final song. Time together has come to an end. It's been really good to see you this morning. Thank you for watching and joining in with this worship. And as I said at the beginning, if you are already part of the Holy Trinity Church family, it's really good to join you in these services. And if you are visiting for the first time, so good to see you. I hope that you'll join us again when our next service goes online. We broadcast services on Wednesday morning and Sunday mornings, and it would be great to see you again. I know that the weather forecast for later today is really good, really sunny, really warm. And so I hope that you have a great day, whatever it is that you're doing. Maybe you'll be able to get out and enjoy some of that sunshine. But as we finish, let's go with God's blessing and God's peace in our hearts. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. We go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Have a great day.